Good afternoon to all those joining us from Europe, and good morning to those doing the same from the United States. Welcome to this event organized by the Naturgy Foundation. The world economy, and the energy sector in particular, is going through a crucially important transformation. The fight against climate change has become entrenched as a central element in politics and strategic decision-making on the part of governments and the private sector. It has also become a driving force for change in society as a whole. As expected, when dealing with a global phenomenon which knows no border, all sectors across the globe are impacted. The fight against climate change is, undoubtedly, made more complex by the unique characteristics of the world economies and indeed each sector in each economy. Not all sectors and not all countries can change at the same speed, nor do they have the same needs, nor the same capacity to adapt. Confronting the challenge and the required speed and adopting the measures in a way that ensures final success through a suitable energy transition is fundamental. For that, it is necessary to conduct a thorough analysis of the following: the current and the past situation, the consequences of our decisions, and the best way to move forward. For this analysis, based on science and facts, a deep understanding and a knowledge of the energy sector is required. And one of the best people suited for this is Professor Vaclav Smil. Professor Vaclav Smil conducts multidisciplinary investigation across a wide range of areas, including energy, environmental and demographic changes, food production, the history of technical innovation, risk evaluation, and public policy. He is a distinguished professor at the University of Manitoba, member of the Royal Society of Canada, and a member of the Order of Canada. He is a global expert in the field of energy, and specifically the evolution of energy transition, which scientific analysis of the data and the possible real-world solutions. He has a broad vision across the energy space, as much from the geographic as from the economy point of view. Today, in the speech that he will deliver, he will provide his vision of energy transition, the speed at which we can expect it to evolve, and also cover the role that natural gas can play in this transition. Regarding both areas, he has published papers that have become globally renowned, and today he will take advantage of this event to present the recently published paper Natural Gas in the New World, written for the Naturgy Foundation, and that we will make available on our web page. Professor Smil, it's truly a privilege to have you with us today. We await the great interest in your presentation, after which we will have a question and answer session. Professor Smil, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Glad to be here. This has to have some structure because the topic is vast and we have a limited time. And so what I will do, I will follow the questions which Manuel posed for me a few days ago. And I will start with the most topical of all things, of course. I was asked to say a few things about the COP26 meeting. What has to be understood in the first place, that this meeting is overwhelmingly a political affair. You can download the conclusions, the last document of the meeting, and you can read what it says. The sentence is always start with, the meeting notes, it recognizes its concern, or it urges, but it has no executive powers. It's not legally binding. It is just simply hoping that something will be done. It's like European countries would meet and would say, oh, we will hope that UK will rejoin EU, or we will hope that Catalonia will love Madrid above Barcelona first. You can say all these things, but they are not legally binding and there are no consequences of not fulfilling your promises, and there are no incentives to fulfill your promises faster. So it's just promises, it's just targets, but if it will happen, nobody can guarantee. Now, there is a more fundamental problem with all of this, and this goes to our need for fossil fuels. If we need to decarbonize, and there should be no debate about it, eventually we will, we have to recognize that there must be a certain pace to this. This, after all, is just the latest of energy transitions. And this is what transition is all about. It's a transition. It's a process. It's not a switch. It's not a turnover. It's not an instant thing. It's a prolonged process. And given the scale of energy problems, given the level of our dependence on fossil fuels, this transition cannot be very fast. And people who think that it could be very fast are raising unrealistic hopes. It just doesn't help to say that we can do it in a matter of years. What we will need are many, many, many decades. And I find it amazing that most people who talk about rapid energy transition apparently are not aware of very fundamental dependence the world has on fossil fuels. So I will start reminding you about the depths of this dependence. The best way how to do it is to talk about our dependence on fossil fuels in terms of primary energy. That is all fuels, fossil or otherwise, that is biomass, and the primary electricity, that is nuclear, hydro, wind, solar, little bit of geothermal, so on. As of 2020, the world has derived 83% of its energy, primary energy, from fossil fuels. In year 2020, two decades ago, it was 87%. So in 20 years, when we try to build as many wind and solar things as possible, and when we try to electrify transportation by introducing electric cars, the world's dependence on fossil fuels declined just by 4%, from 87 to 83. Now the latest COP26 meeting says that we should reduce our dependence on carbon by 45% in the next 9 years, by 2030. So in 20 years, it's 4% down. Now in 9 years, it should be 45% down. So in past 20 years, we reduce our dependence on carbon by 0.2% a year. Now we should be reducing it by 5% a year, which is 25 times faster. Now I ask you the simple question, what is in place for the next year, 2022, which will allow us to reduce our dependence on carbon 25 times faster than we did this year, or the last year, or the year before? So it's very easy to say, you know, 45% down by 2030, but is it a realistic target? Now, we must realize, of course, that there are different sectors which can move at very different speeds. It's relatively easy to decarbonize electricity generation. I say relatively easy because there is a limit to it as well. But we can, because the costs are affordable, and we know very well that the capital cost of solar photovoltaic, even solar central power and wind are very good now. So we can build as many of these installations as fast as possible. And so we can decrease our dependence on electricity generated from fossil fuels. But you take a look even at this sector, and you will see how highly dependent this sector is also on fossil fuels. The electricity generation is not as dependent on fossil fuels overall primary energy consumption, but it's also highly dependent. In most countries of the world, over 60%, the world average is about 60%, and in some countries like China, India, it's more than 70%. So even that sector cannot be decarbonized in a matter of years. Again, it'll take decades. Moreover, once we get into high dependence on intermittent sources, that is on wind and solar, we have to increase our reserve capacity. And the perfect example of it happened in Europe this spring and this summer, when the wind frequency and wind strength was lower than usual. And as a result, there was not enough electricity generated by wind. Instead of normal 15 to 18% coming every day from wind in Europe, this year on some days, it was only as little as 5% every day. As a result, Europe had to resort to more natural gas and even to more coal. So Germany, which has invested so much into wind generation, during the first half of 2021, generated more electricity from coal than from wind. So even the energy transition in the electricity sector from coal and natural gas to wind and solar has to be done at a measured pace. Otherwise, you outrun your reserve capacities and will have problems with supplying the market. Now, this transition must be understood also, it will develop at very different rates in different countries. And there is nothing new about this. This has been always the case. Perhaps the best example in Europe is Netherlands. The Dutch discovered large reserves of natural gas in Groningen, in northern Netherlands, in 1959. And just 15 years later, 1974, they shut down all of their coal mines. So you might say the energy transition from the discovery of natural gas to the last mining of coal in Netherlands, it was just 15 years. So you could have a rapid local energy transition. Similarly in Norway, Norway generates all of its electricity from hydro, and it's very cheap. So in Norway, it's very easy once you basically pay people to buy or to acquire electric cars, is to electrify transportation. So in Norway now, 80, 90%, even more than slightly more than 90% of all new cars bought every month are now electric. Very easy. If you have all that cheap electricity and if you subsidize in a small country, the purchase of these cars, very easy to electrify very rapidly. Now that is not the case in places like US, in Canada, where electric cars are a very, very small percentage of new car purchases. And in US, you have more than 200 million vehicles to replace. So electricity transition or energy transition to electric cars in US cannot happen that rapidly as it will happen or as it is happening in Norway. And of course, you have China and India, which are at very different stages of development. India basically comparatively is at a stage where Europe was about 80 years ago. China is now at the stage that Europe was in 1960s after rushing very rapidly from situation like before the Second World War into the current situation. Chinese energy per capita consumption quadrupled in just 20 years from 25 to about 100 gigajoules per capita. So China has been running through very, very fast energy transition from biomass fuels, from wood and straw into fossil fuels. And it's extremely highly dependent on fossil fuels. So it will not be able to become a decarbonized country for decades and decades to come. As you know, the Chinese official promise is 2060, but it's so far away that people who are running the country now will not be around in 2060. To be responsible for those promises, which most unlikely will not be fulfilled. Now, I am astonished that people do not pay more attention to natural gas in all of this. Some do, but most don't. Natural gas is a perfect fuel for energy transition in its early stages, for decarbonization in its early stages. Because combustion of natural gas for the unit of energy generates about 40% less carbon than combustion of coal, and more than 20% less carbon than the combustion of refined liquid fuels like kerosene, diesel, or gasoline. So it's a perfect intermediate choice, perfect intermediate fuel, going from high carbon coal to non-carbon renewables, wind or solar or hydrogen or other non-carbon fuels. So we should be pushing the consumption of natural gas as a replacement for coal, a replacement for liquefied, for refined liquid fuels as much as possible. Now, there is the argument that, of course, the production of natural gas generates unwanted methane during the extraction, during the transportation, there'll be some leakage, and methane being more powerful greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide may actually work against natural gas and making it as bad as coal. This may be true if the operation is run poorly, irresponsibly, but if the operation is run properly, if the wells are drilled properly, if they are secured properly, if the transmission lines are monitored for leaks, if everything is done along the line as it should be, then definitely natural gas is a much preferred fuel for coal, to coal. And you can look at the United States as the best example of this. It's the best example also, you don't have to adhere to any meeting or organization or agreement, which is no binding force anyway. During most of the second decade of the 21st century, U.S. did not belong to Paris Treaty. You know, certainly that Trump was no friend of Paris Treaty or another climate agreements. Yet the United States, between 2010 and 2020, cut down its dependence on carbon, that is, it reduced carbon emissions by 8.5%. You could look up the figures and you see Germany, which belonged to Paris Agreement, which has explicit policies of decarbonization, which is investing hundreds of millions of euro into Energiewende. But what percentage Germany reduced its dependence on carbon between 2010 and 2020? Well, by 8.5%, exactly as much, or almost exactly as much as Americans have done. And how did Americans achieve that thing? Not by building record numbers of wind and solar capacities. They did that too, of course. But above all, by shifting their electricity generation massively from coal, closing down all these old coal-fired power plants, many of them built 1950s, 1960s, and turning to natural gas, generated mostly using gas turbines, and gas turbines in combined facilities with high 60% energy efficiency. So this is how America reduced its carbon emissions by nearly 10% by turning from coal to natural gas. And if China would be following the same trend now with increased imports of natural gas from Russia and LNG from Middle East and from Australia, China would be also shedding slowly its dependence on carbon from coal. So natural gas is a unique fossil fuel. It still, of course, generates carbon, but given the fact that it produces so much less than coal, and given the fact that it's so flexible, so transportable, and given the fact that we can burn it in combined cycle turbines with 60% efficiency, actually now the best turbines are a little bit over 60%, which is an efficiency unequaled by any other converter of fossil fuel. The best diesel engines are about 50%. So this is an excellent way how to move slowly into decarbonization by turning to natural gas. Now, of course, as we know, there is a problem, global problem, except for North America, really, so otherwise it's global, with the supply of natural gas. And the problem is especially severe in Europe, because Europe somehow miscalculated. Europe should have realized that the Dutch production, which is now really winding down, will be eventually terminated. Europe knew that the North Sea production will be coming less and less intensive and will not be able to supply the previous demand. And Europe should have realized that it's not to its best interest to be dependent on the Russian gas to such a high degree. Now, of course, these things are well known, and Europe has made steps to diversify the supply by importing LNG from other sources, especially from Middle East, and also somewhat from the United States. But this has been the missed opportunity, especially with large increases of natural gas production in the US, which hydraulic fraction brought around, that Europe and US should have entered into some grant agreement about mass supply of natural gas to Europe. I know it's not easily done. There are always different political preferences, but that was a great missed opportunity, because Europe now finds itself with great shortage of natural gas, which is not going to disappear. The current very high prices are not to last forever. They'll come down, but they will not return to low prices of the past. And there'll be always these supply shortages for foreseeable future, and I mean for years and years to come, because as you've just heard this morning, Nord Stream 2, which was to help to alleviate the shortage, is even further away from delivering gas to Germany, because Germany now insists, of course, on the transfer of legal entity from Switzerland to Germany before the pipeline could be filled, before the pipeline will start operating. So unfortunately, Europe cannot take as much of the advantage of using this great low carbon fossil fuel as is happening in the United States and in Canada. Now, I should address also another very important thing I was asked to talk about, and that is, in the long run, what is the relationship between the energy consumption and economic growth? And people frequently use this very unfortunate term of decoupling. People are talking about decoupling of economic growth from energy consumption. That is a wrong term, because decoupling means, you know, it's coupled and it's decoupled. It has nothing to do with each other. That is very wrong. What we are constantly doing, without any COP agreements or without any decarbonization targets or goals, we are constantly increasing the efficiency of our energy conversion. We are installing better furnaces, better engines, better turbines. We are increasing the efficiency all along the line, always, every year. And these are small and cumulative improvements, but eventually they bring big shifts and big gains. Let me give you a few examples. As I mentioned a while ago, we now have combined cycle gas turbines, which are more than 60% efficient. 50 years ago, the typical steam turbine in electricity generation was only 30% efficient. So we doubled our efficiency of electricity generation in the best with the best turbines. Our internal combustion engine, the classical one, gasoline one, that used to be 15-20% efficient. Now the best of them are approaching the efficiency of diesel engines, which also used to be like 25-30% efficient. And now the best diesels are 50% efficient. When you fly the latest jetliner, Boeing 787, it's now consuming per seat, per passenger seat, per kilometer, 70% less kerosene than the Boeing 707 was consuming in the late 1950s. So this is what we are doing constantly. We are improving the efficiency of conversion, and as a result, we need less energy per dollar of GDP. So energy intensity of our economies is declining, but we cannot decouple them totally. What we are doing, that we are producing more GDP with less joule or less energy per unit of GDP. But there is a limit to it. If I have 100 passengers to transport by a plane from Madrid to Paris, there is a certain minimum cost which I cannot go below. There is a simple equation, right? Kinetic energy, half mv squared, and even when I run with 100% efficiency engine, I have to deliver that. The same thing is true about producing materials. Every year, we have been producing materials with little less energy cost. So it used to cost us 50 gigajoules per ton to produce 1 ton of steel. Now we are down in best facilities to about 12, 13 gigajoules per ton. But to take iron ore and coke and to smelt it in iron big blast furnace and then to decarbonize that iron and make steel, the minimum requirement is on the order of about 10 tons, 10 gigajoules per ton. You cannot go below that. That's the stoichiometric minimum. You cannot produce steel with less than 10 gigajoules per ton. And we already are at about 12 gigajoules per ton. And you never can go below 10. So you cannot decouple energy and production of steel. You cannot decouple energy and production of ammonia. There the minimum is about 20 gigajoules per ton. You cannot decouple the minimum to transport so many people from A to B. You can just increase the efficiency. So there is always the last minimum, thermodynamic minimum, below which you cannot go. So this is very important to remember that in many cases, our efficiencies are so good already that we don't have much space left. When you take the original, one more example, when you take the original steam engine, less than 10% efficient. So to go from A to B, you would have to consume 100. You get the internal combustion engine, gasoline, 30% efficient. So you have to consume only 30, right? You get into electric vehicle and 90% efficient, so you can consume only less than 10 or something like that. But still, you know, you cannot decouple transportation from energy or materials from energy. You just can improve the efficiencies. Now, unfortunately, in many cases, our efficiencies are still far too high. We would want to decrease them. And the problem is, of course, that in some cases, our conversion or storage capacities are totally inadequate. And here I want to turn to the last big item, what we have to do with this transition, namely, what is needed? What has to be invented? What has to be introduced? 2 weeks ago, Bill Gates said something which should be repeated again and again and again. Bill said that at least half of all new technologies needed to perform this decarbonization transition are either not invented or are known but cost too much money. What is not invented is easy to list. Above all, we do not have high energy density storage, electricity storage batteries. Our batteries, even the best ones, are still very lousy. Our best batteries now in commercial use, not in research or, you know, some university testing. Our best commercial batteries are roughly 300 watt hours per kilogram, 300. Kerosene and diesel are 12,000 watt hours per kilogram. So that's a 40-fold difference. So we would have to increase the energy density of our batteries 40 times to equal fossil fuels. So then you could put batteries into your jetliner and you can fly with electric batteries instead of with flying kerosene. You see that flying on batteries is not going to happen anytime fast, because to increase the energy density of batteries 40 times is not a matter of 4 years or 10 years. It will take us very, very, very long time, if ever, I might add. You can look at other things. We know perfectly how to produce hydrogen. Now, most of it, of course, we produce from natural gas. So if people think, you know, or we move from fossil fuel to hydrogen, well, right now we produce worldwide about 75 million tons of hydrogen. All of it is produced basically from natural gas. So that's not a green hydrogen. But we know how to produce green hydrogen as well. You could produce it from electrolysis of water. But that is the second part of what Bill said. We know how to do it, but it costs too much. So to produce another 70 or 100 million tons of hydrogen, to have hydrogen cars, or to have hydrogen processes in industries, or to have hydrogen-made steel, we would need to increase the cost of it we would need to decrease the cost of it very massively. We would need simply to get not only green, but very cheap hydrogen, and we don't have that yet. So this is the problem with transition, our high dependence on fossil fuels, that we haven't paid enough attention in many countries to use the best fossil fuel for transition, that is natural gas. The fact that you can never uncouple the dependence from between natural, between economic growth and the fuel and the energy, you can reduce it, but you cannot never uncouple it. And the fact that many of the things which we need to accomplish this transition as rapidly as possible have yet to be invented, or we have these techniques, but they are still very expensive, so they cannot be deployed on mass scale, especially by poor countries. Now, the final question which I was asked to address by Manuel is to say something about what individuals can do. Very limited, the individual action. This is a global problem, and the atmosphere, that is the warming, is the result of the global total of CO2 in the atmosphere. So if you as an individual will just totally become a monk and go to a cave and just eat some dry fruits and don't travel and just meditate, the amount of carbon dioxide you will save as an individual will be made up by what China, India needs to increase its energy consumption, because the countries are at the lower stage of development than we are. They will make up for it in a matter of seconds. Even small countries, like if you take Latvia or Estonia or Portugal, the annual carbon emission in those countries are less than the rounding error of the Chinese coal emissions, because we don't know the Chinese emissions down to the last ton. So it's all just estimates and rounding. So there is very limited amount which an individual can do, no matter if you stop eating beef or if you stop traveling by plane, or if you just keep walking instead of taking car. What it requires is just simply a slow, gradual, multi-decadal process of turning from one form of energy to another form of energy. We've done it before with going from wood to coal, then from coal to oil, then from oil to natural gas. Now we are going, we're still moving into natural gas and moving into renewables and perhaps into more nuclear, although nuclear doesn't have too many friends. But it's important to remember that this is a transition, not a switch, that it will take a long time, and it would be, and it is highly responsible for people to say that we can accomplish in a matter of years, only a matter of decade. I'll stop at this point, and I'll be glad to take any questions you have. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Vaclav. As always, it has been a really, really impressive and interesting lecture. And as always, also based on facts and based on your scientific knowledge and the reality of the world we are living in. Indeed, we are just in the middle of this energy transition, as you used to emphasize. No, you did it this afternoon. This is a transition, and in this way it should be considered. But at the same time, we are now facing the problem of the fight against climate change, so it means that probably is an energy transition is slightly different than some others in the past. Okay, we now begin the second part of the session, question and answers, and you know you can submit your questions through the platform that you have at your disposal in the webcast. There are many questions already submitted, and I hope that we will be able to raise those issues in which you are expressing the most interest. First of all, you talk, Vaclav, about Glasgow, about the COP in Glasgow. I would like if you can talk a little more about regarding if you see any kind of influence on the evolution of the energy transition, and specifically, which is your opinion about the CO2, the carbon pricing, the CO2 markets? If this will be a tool which could or can help in this reduction of on this energy transition?
You mean the carbon tax?
Yeah, carbon tax.
Yeah. Well, you know, in the first place, as I said, you know, it's always been all the COP meetings have been misunderstood. These are not international treaties. Treaty is a binding agreement. You sign the treaty and you are obligated by that treaty to adhere to it and to meet the targets or to meet the promises or whatever, right? So if you sign the treaty as a country entering the EU, you have obligations. And if you don't meet those obligations, the Brussels would see to it that you keep on meeting those obligations. Now, the COP meetings are just that. They are just meetings. They don't carry any obligations, maybe some kind of moral obligations, but no legally binding obligations. And moreover, you can reduce the problem, actually, you know, so it's a global problem, but we have 200 countries. But it's really not necessary or it's irrelevant what Ethiopia or Sri Lanka would do. I mean, these are important, populous, big economies in many ways, but in terms of carbon emissions, it's very, very low. So what matters is what these five big actors will do. China, which is number one, out of 37 billion tons, it's producing 11 billion tons of CO2 every year. And then, of course, United States, and then EU, and then Russia, and then India. So what is required for, you know, even if it's not a legally binding treaty, what is required for COP to work is for these five big emitters to work together and to come to some agreement. And you've seen at last meeting, COP26, that these five big emitters have not come to any agreement. India objected against even saying phasing out coal. So India insisted for the whole day before the final agreement started saying phasing down coal, not phasing out, because India remains a big coal country. Right? Russia didn't even bother to attend, so to speak, right? So you see, it's extremely difficult to get agreement even among five countries, or EU being a group of countries which matter really. So how will you get an agreement on actual taxation rate, whatever it should be, 2%, 5%, 10%, 15%, among 200 countries of the world? So just from that point of view, because that agreement would have to be legal and binding, because what's the point of saying, you know, some countries will have it, some countries will not have it. If a country says, I'll be taxing myself 15%, disadvantaging my industries, and China will be taxing 0%, putting their industries at advantage, who will want to be part of such an agreement? So I just don't see how the countries which cannot even sign something kind of promising on a dotted line, how they will sign something legally binding. So I don't see any global carbon tax anytime soon, regardless if it's a good thing or bad thing to have. It's a totally different debate. I'm just talking about what are the chances of, forget about 200, but even like 20 or 50 major countries, even five major countries coming to an agreement and saying, we will have a binding common carbon tax. I just don't see that happening at all.
Okay. Okay. There are several questions about China and a worldwide view about the energy markets, and specifically about the gas markets. You talked about if China shift their generation from coal to gas, yeah. There are some questions about could this situation create a problem or tension in the gas natural prices? And linked with all of this, do you see any problem regarding the gas natural reserves all over the world, or in terms of production or investigation?
Well, you know, China already, as you know, is deeply, deeply engaged in the global gas market. Some of the world's largest pipelines are now taking gas from Siberia to China, from Central Asia to China. And China, of course, is now the major player in LNG, bringing LNG wherever they can get from Australia. So China already is a huge player. But people have to realize that what happened in China so far is nothing, nothing compared to what could happen in China in the next 10, 15, 20 years. Because again, this shows the massive dependence on our fossil fuel. Think of it that China is now mining every year more than 4 billion tons of coal. More than 4 billion tons of coal every year. So just to reduce its debt, imagine if China, you can do those calculations, it's easy to do this back of the envelope calculation. If China would reduce its dependence on coal by just 50%, it's replacing 2 billion tons of coal. That's more coal than it's mined in the rest of the world together, right? So Chinese hunger for natural gas is virtually unlimited, really, right? And one thing which I always advise people to do is never to forecast in long run, right? Because after all, that hunger couldn't be realized because you cannot develop this new capacity so fast. So that's there is a natural limit, you know, to satisfying that hunger, really, right? But there is absolutely no doubt that when you add the other hunger as well, because don't forget there is India, and there is Middle East, and there is Africa, which needs to develop and which needs natural gas as well, that the potential for natural gas, that we could easily double its production in the next 20 years, and it still might not be enough. But the question is now, will we double it? Because people are stopping to invest in developing natural gas. So this is a problem which kind of, you know, is almost frightening to think about, because the potential is just almost endless for new demand, but the development is now very limited.
Yeah, a real issue, really. Yes. There are several questions about different technologies. I will start with nuclear technology. Now it's on the table again about what we should do with the nuclear power plants. Which is your vision on that, and specifically probably with the small power nuclear power plants that has been developed?
I, whenever I'm asked this, I'm always doing, you know, throw my hands and say, just forget it. Okay, let's start with the flavor of the week or fashion of the month. That is the small modular nuclear reactors. The concept of these little machines goes back to early 1980s, when it became quite clear in the US that the breeder reactor, which was the great hope, during the 1970s, the nuclear people in U.S. believed that by the end of the century, by year 2000, all electricity in U.S. will be generated by nuclear fission, and most of it, not just by standard pressurized water reactors or boiling water reactors, but it will be generated by breeder reactors. So people in the U.S. believe in 70s, early 80s, that the breeder reactors are the future. But of course, breeder reactors have their well-known technical problems working with liquid sodium, etc. And all the breeder reactor development in the US was stopped in 1983. So the people came up with the great replacement. Oh, we'll turn to small modular nuclear reactors. We'll be able to build them fast and it'll be much cheaper, because the old reactors were, you know, they took decades to build, very expensive. So this is 1981, 1980 to 1983. 93, 03, 13, almost 20. So it's almost 40 years. So we've been talking and talking and talking about small modular nuclear reactors. Could you show me one which is now commercial, operating, cheap, inexpensive, and reliable? No, you can't, right? We are still talking about them. Now, some of them are now approaching that stage when we might eventually get them, but we still do not have them. And because they are small, we would need very large number of them to make up the capacities of the coal-fired power plants. Because the large coal-fired power plants are, you know, 1 gigawatt, many hundreds of megawatts, 1-2 gigawatts. And if you have a small reactor of 50 megawatts, well, you know, you will need a large number of them to replace all those aging coal or natural gas plants. So small reactors, I would say, you know, when I see them, I'll tell you they are good. When I see them in their hundreds or thousands, right? As far as the big ones, you say they are on the table. They are and they aren't. They are on the table in France, because France always, for the past 30 years, derived more than 70% of its electricity from nuclear. But Germany, as you know, the number one economy in EU, is closing down all of them next year by law. They just hate them, right? So there is no love lost. I mean, Europe mostly hates nuclear. You know, many countries, Italy never even built a single reactor. There are some countries which wouldn't touch the nuclear with a long pole, right? Italy, Germany, Austria, right? There are some countries which build them, Czech Republic, Spain, but, you know, not so good. So I just don't see, this has nothing to do, again, you know, the question of our carbon tax has nothing to do if it's good or bad. But what are the possibilities of it actually being adopted and enacted? So with nuclear, you can engage in the debate. Is it good or bad? But that's besides the point, because many countries don't want even to consider it. Some like it, but many absolutely don't like it. So I just don't see how Europe can move strongly into nuclear when its number one economy is absolutely dead set against nuclear.
It's true, yeah. There are some other questions regarding different technologies, some of them regarding the storage, energy storage. And a specific one is about the role you can see the hydroelectric storage. And general question is about which is the main technology you see in the future, in your opinion, no? Taking into account that some great developments have to be done.
Look, you might reuse the world energy problem to this, basically. There is plenty of sunshine in all kinds of places, maybe not in Seattle or maybe not in Scotland, but there is plenty of sunshine. And the photovoltaic panels are cheap now. So basically, you know, we could just pave a large part, or not so large, but part of Sahara with photovoltaic panels. And it's cheap. We could generate the electricity, PV electricity. And if we would have cheap mass-scale storage, then we would just store it and distribute it around the world and would be done. There will be no global energy problem. But that is the problem. We do not have a mass-scale, affordable, high-intensity, high-density electricity storage. Again, you know, people have these misconceptions because we are making better batteries, putting them together. We are now storing like 100 megawatts here, 100 megawatts there. That's peanuts, of course, 100 megawatts. You still look at global storage, and more than 95% of all global electricity storage is pumped hydro storage. One reservoir low, one reservoir high. Overnight, you pump water up. During the high demand, you let the water go down, and you lose about 25% of electricity pumping that water up. So it's not that terribly efficient, 75%, not so badly. But that is 95% of the world electricity storage is pumped hydro storage. The rest of it is less than 5%, and less of it is still of very low intensity, very low energy and power density. And the highs, even when you take so many of those batteries and put them together, it's only like 100 meg. The biggest one this year will be 100 megawatts for 2 or 4 hours. What is 100 megawatts for 2 or 4 hours? Don't forget that most of the population in the world now is in Asia, and most of the population lives in mega cities. And mega cities, more than 10 million people, New Delhi, Tokyo, Beijing, Shanghai. These cities need each of them more than 10, more than 20 gigawatts of electricity, nonstop, all the time. That's the base load, 10 gigawatts. Try to store just 10 gigawatts of electricity for one day for one megacity, when the biggest storage is now 100 megawatts for a couple hours away, right? So with our electricity storage, we are not even at the beginning of the process. We are kind of still underground, waiting to emerge like a little seedling to catch some sunlight. So this is the most important thing. This is where the breakthrough is needed. We would need cheap, affordable, mass-scale electricity storage. And there is nothing on the horizon being like 5-10 years. There's nothing on the horizon. We are constantly improving the density of our batteries, but still, as I said, our batteries are, our fossil fuels are still 40 times more energy dense than our best batteries. So this is the one thing where the breakthrough is needed most. We need superior electricity storage. Once we get it, most of our problem is global energy is solved.
Uh-huh. Okay, thank you, Vaclav. Another technology you talk about it before is the hydrogen, or we can talk about renewable gases, you know, biogas, hydrogen. The cost, you talk about the cost in this, but do you see it is as an option to help to this decarbonization process, just in the case that the cost will be reduced in the future? You know that we are talking a lot about green hydrogen and so on. No? And yeah. Do you see the cost going down?
There are several different things here. When you look at biogas, of course, you have to have a feedstock for it. So you have to get it from somewhere. So you have to have either straw or some organic crops you can grow. You can go straw because that's kind of a waste, or you can grow direct organic crops and then to gasify them. And for that, you need land. So this is the question of power density. Growing crops is very, very low energy density. That's less than, in terms of power density, is less than one, usually less than half watt per square meter. So if you would elevate biogas to one, to be a major source of gas, you need very, very large areas of land, which means very large areas of fertilizer, very large areas of water to irrigate it, very large amount of machinery to harvest it, and very large facilities to gasify it and in biogasification. So on a large scale, on a local scale, on a maybe small regional scale, that's fine. But as a global solution, biogas, it just simply doesn't cut it. Now, hydrogen would be fine if I would get that energy storage. You see, this is the problem with green hydrogen. Suppose I build it next to a very large photovoltaic station, but the photovoltaic station is out during the night. So, and my hydrogen production would have to run 24 hours a day. Otherwise, it would be terribly uneconomical. So again, I would need large battery storage going with it. Or I put it right next door to a big wind farm in North Sea. So again, wind doesn't blow. I would need a mass storage. So making hydrogen green is not only the locating it next to the facilities which are producing renewable electricity, but also combining with the large scale storage. And so this is why the best way is to put it right next door to large hydro station, because there I can have a electricity at demand and operate it 24 hours a day. But otherwise it's a very, very tall task, because I have to combine the better form of generating it with better form of providing and delivering and securing the electricity 24 hours for it. Let's again talk about the scale that we are using now, about 4 billion tons. Suppose you decide to go for hydrogen in transportation, like Toyota decided to do. So you have a fuel cell and hydrogen. Globally, we use, let's say, something on the order of 2 billion tons of refined fuel for transportation. 2 billion tons. And it's about 40 gigajoules per ton. Hydrogen is 120. So, you divide by 3. So instead of 2 billion, you will need something on the order of 600 million tons of hydrogen to do that. Today, our production of all hydrogen from natural gas is 75 million tons. And to replace transportation would be on the order of 600, 700 million tons. So 10 times as much of green hydrogen as we are producing hydrogen from natural gas reforming. So you can see the scale of the problem again. So it's not that it couldn't be done. Theoretically, it's very easy to say we could do it, but practically, you must see that we cannot have now producing 75 million tons of nitrogen gas derived hydrogen. We cannot have industry producing hundreds of million tons of green hydrogen in a matter of year or two when we now have zero facilities producing green hydrogen. So everything again is a matter of scale and time.
Another technology, we have some questions about it, that is now seems to be appearing again in the discussion, in the debate, is about carbon capture and storage. I don't know if you see it as something that could help. Probably we'll come back again to the scale, the scale issue.
Let's talk about scale of the problem, right?
Yeah.
As you might have read, the only quote-unquote commercial facility is Orca in Iceland, okay? And it's green, it was put in Iceland because it has a steady, again, you see, Orca wasn't put, to get a green electricity, it wasn't put next to a photovoltaic station, because during the night it wouldn't have the electricity storage. It was put next to a geothermal plant in Iceland, right? So that geothermal plant, that hot steam is coming out of the ground all the time, so it's able to provide green electricity, which is needed for that capture of carbon from the air. That Orca facility capturing carbon from the air is 4,000 tons a year, 4,000 tons a year. We are producing worldwide 37 billion tons of carbon dioxide a year, 37 billion tons. So 10% is 3.7 billion tons, so roughly 4 billion tons. So to capture 10%, and there will be still, you know, 90% will be still going into the air. So to capture 10%, we need to capture 4 billion tons. This facility in Iceland is 4,000 tons, so 1,000 to billion, right? That's the difference of six orders of magnitude, million-fold difference. So you see how many Orca facilities you would have to capture just 10% of CO2. I stop at this point. You can make the deduction. Again, the scale is forget about the cost. Forget about the cost. Just the scale, right? 4,000 tons versus 4 billion tons just to capture 10% of CO2.
Yeah, it's true. The scale issue, no, is always there. No?
I'm sorry. I have to repeat these things, but this is the world we live in. That's the only one. We don't live in the world of fantasies. That may be, you know, science fiction may be good for books and, you know, maybe good some for some internet postings by some teenagers. But we live in the real world where we deal with 37 billion tons of CO2. Produced every year by a society which depends 83% on fossil fuels. That's the reality of the world.
Question is that the citizen, you talk about the citizen, and I would like to ask you that probably I know the answer, but do you think that in terms of communication, we are doing it well or not, in the sense that is the citizen really aware of the implications of the demands that sometimes we can see in the media?
Well, this is absolutely, this is a key question to ask. And the answer is that it's just off out there. Basically, most people now think that energy transition is like getting a new cell phone. You get a new mobile, you have an old cell phone, it doesn't have any pictures. Then you get a new mobile, it has all these pictures and connectivity. So you just throw out away the old one, get a new one. Well, it's not like that. It's 10 billion tons of coal, oil, and natural gas. And this is burned in 1.4 billion vehicles. There are 1.4 billion fuel vehicles on the road. Right? Cars and trucks and all the things that go, right? There are tens of thousands of jetliners, tens of thousands of container ships and big bulk ships around the world, right? More than 1 billion people require fuel for heating. I have this beautiful natural gas furnace, which is keeping me warm because now there is a snow outside of my window, really. So more than 1 billion people need natural gas heating, right? 1.4 billion vehicles. We produce more than 1 billion tons of steel using coke, which is made from coal, really. So this is not like, you know, getting a new model of something, really, right? So this is to answer your question, is the awful job. People are not aware of the reality at all because people think it's just simply changing something for something else. No, it's not changing something for something else. It's changing the fundamentals of the world, because every economic transaction presupposes and contains and involves energy conversion. So basically, decarbonizing our world is changing its fundamental operation. It took us 200 years to get into this level of dependence of carbon. And now we think that we can get rid of it in a matter of years. It's just simply impossible because scale is just simply too big. Even when you forget about the cost of it, and the cost of it is not trivial. Cost of it is just absolutely massive. And cost of it is also underappreciated.
Yes, we are almost getting to the end of the session. But I have the easy question now to finish the session. No? Well, let me say that in your recent book, The Energy and Civilization, A History, which is a really impressive overview of how energy has driven the cultural and economic progress of human society, you talk, and you have talking about it right now, about the economic growth and the coupling with energy. I have a very easy question about all of this, and it's, so what is the solution? What is the solution? How can we put together all this economic growth, this energy consumption, and the fight against climate change? I know that this is there is no answer clearly for that. No?
Yeah, there is no. Yeah, because above all, again, to answer it properly, there is no simple answer. But you can start answering it, but it requires to chop it down into smaller pieces, and there are many smaller pieces. One small piece, of course, is Europe, right? Europe is now about only 5% of the world population, right? But Europe has been living very, and the same is for North America, right? EU now is about 440 million people. North America is similar number of people. So it is possible for us in Europe and North America to reduce our absolute consumption of energy without suffering very much. People forget that you could reduce our per capita energy consumption by 10%, 20%, even 30%, and we would be returning only back to 1970s or 1980s, right, or 1960s, depending on the country. So as far as the solution goes, we could keep on gradually introducing better, more efficient techniques and decarbonizing every year bit by bit while also reducing our overall energy consumption. We can do it in countries which are already consuming so much, and that's North America, EU, Japan, right. Then you have countries which are consuming quite a bit, and there is China. Is, you know, EU is about 130 150 gigajoules per capita. China is about 100, so they are already coming to EU level, but that's the average figure. Many people in China are still very poor, so China still needs to do a lot more. But think of the fact that India is 25 gigajoules per capita. India is just one quarter of China. So India, to catch up China, would have to quadruple, four times its energy consumption. So we can ask ourselves, we should and we could reduce energy consumption. But India, to reach some decent quality of life, has to increase its energy consumption massively. So EU 130, China 100, India 25, but Africa less than 15. Sub-Saharan Africa, less than 10. So Africa would have to do 10 times China to reach China today, really. So you see that there is no possibility how we can ask people, even in China, but especially in India or Africa, to reduce their energy consumption. They must multiply their energy consumption, which will put another pressure on the demand for coal, oil, natural gas, on solar or wind, on everything. Because they consume so little, they will take any form of energy they can get to raise the standard of living, really, right? So this is a global problem, but we have the luxury of reducing our use. They don't have the luxury, they must increase their use. And this is not sufficiently understood, you know, that you cannot ask people who are consuming 1/20 or 5% what you do to sacrifice. Those people will. So this is what you see what's happening already. For these really poorest countries in the world, they say, we will move in the direction of decarbonization only when you rich countries will pay for it, right? And they're asking for hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars, right? So there is the answer to your question, really. More money, and again, people underappreciate how much money eventually it will cost. Hundreds of billions are not enough. We are talking about trillions and trillions, really. So again, you know, the message has been wrong. People have been misinformed about how long it will take and how much money it will cost. There is no simple, rapid, and cheap solution to this, because it's the fundamental reworking of our society.
Impressive, really impressive. But we are getting to the end of the session. We have some more questions, but unfortunately we have no time. I think that we could spend here hours and hours and days or weeks talking about that. Vaclav, as always, it has been a real pleasure and a privilege for us to having you with us and listen to your vision. And you always say your insistence on that we should base our decision on the reality of the world and on the data and the figures, and that will be the only way to achieve the ambitious objectives that we have set. Thank you very much again. We hope that we can meet next year, probably, and we hope that physically
thank
that
you
can come to Spain. And to all of you, thank you very much for your presence. And I would like to remind that in the Naturgy Foundation website, we have the document written by Vaclav about the natural gas in the new energy world, where he reviews or gives an overall analysis of its situation and the role that, in his opinion, could play in the future. It's in our website. Thank you very much again for all of you, and I hope the session has been of your interest, and see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.